You've arrived at module 5. Now we get to talk about how we can visualize report data in our report layouts. We're going to talk about visualizing report data, and our initial focus will be on creating data regions. And then we'll come back in the next video and look at data visualizations. Recall that it's on the Insert Ribbon tab where you can insert data regions and data visualizations. So what do we mean by data regions and visualizations? Well, let's introduce that the data region is actually what we call a tablex. Tablex has variants of table, matrix, and list. And that's where the word tablex comes from.
True.
TAB from table.
Yeah, you had a really cool slide that mixed them together.
Yeah, it doesn't quite do that.
Yeah.
Well, but if you can use your imagination and you can merge all of those together, you sort of come up with the word tablex. So we'll focus on the tablex initially. It provides flexible grid layouts, and you've already seen the list in demo. Mm-hmm. Provided a repeatable template with a rectangle. The data visualizations give us charts and gauges and maps, data bars, sparklines, and indicators, and we'll come back to these in a later recording. So all data regions, as I've just mentioned, are variants of the tablex. And the tablex enables very flexible grid layout and with groupings. And when rendered, the data region will expand according to the data in your configuration. So here's the interesting thing. We've talked about page layouts and the importance of margins and sizes to ensure that it prints appropriately and we don't have blank pages.
Mm-hmm.
But depending on the configuration of your tablex, we may not know what size it will be, horizontally or vertically.
Correct.
Because it's based on the data and, of course, the filters that are being applied.
Yes.
So the reason that Report Builder distinguishes a group of visualizations as data regions is that these, we don't know at design time what size they will be.
Exactly.
Whereas the data visualizations are fixed in size, like a chart, it will not expand beyond what you've configured at design time. All right, so we'll talk about the visualizations later. The focus will be now to talk about the variants of a tablex.
Mm-hmm.
So use the tablex for flexible grid layouts. The table is characterized by fixed columns and dynamic rows, whereas the matrix, for those familiar with pivot tables in Excel,
yes,
they have groupings on columns and rows. So while the table will grow vertically, the matrix can grow in both directions.
Yeah, and you saw this during the wizard earlier when we actually had to choose what were our column items and what were our row items. So you have that ability in both.
Right. So what happened in the wizard, though, we didn't configure anything on the columns.
No.
So therefore, the wizard produced a table. But if we did add something to the columns, it would produce a matrix.
Yep. So you need to keep that in mind when you're setting that up.
Correct. The list you've already seen, it is a variant of the tablex. It's the simplest form.
Yes.
It's simply a rectangle, and the rectangle will repeat for each of your groupings. Now, when it comes to the groupings of the tablex, there are these three types. You've got nested, which if you think of drilling into a hierarchy from country to state, province to city. What's interesting about the flexibility that a tablex gives us is that we can also have adjacent groupings. So the same data could be represented horizontally by different groups.
Mm-hmm.
And then recursive groups are supported as well, that if you have parent-child data, and I think the classic example of this would be an employee table where each employee has a relationship to another employee, their boss, right?
Exactly right.
So we could also generate a parent-child hierarchy by using a tablex.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see why it's called a tablex. Stay tuned. This is the reason why.
Ah.
Do you see the way that what was a table and what had something, a grouping of columns, is now produced a single grid that has nested groups and adjacent groups? Let's do it again. All right, table and matrix together. On the left, a table that has fixed columns. On the right, the matrix that has a grouping on year.
Mm-hmm.
Potentially, it'll have 2020, 2021 in the future as well. And yet, we can produce a single grid to achieve this result.
Yeah, and that's incredibly powerful.
It is. So it is up to you as a report author to express the data in exactly the way that it makes sense to you.
Yep.
Now, this is something that Power BI reports couldn't do.
No, and this is an area where a lot of people look for this type of functionality in their Power BI reports. They're looking to do exactly this, and Paginated Reports is the answer for this type of scenario.
And also what's interesting to note is that there are render formats that are data formats. So this can be a way of transforming your data for export into other formats like XML and CSV.
Exactly.
And you can structure and transform the data precisely to what is required. So a discussion now about the grouping of a tablex. remember there's a grouping pane that you see beneath the report canvas. And I'll point out, we discussed that variables were possible at reports. I'll just add now that variables can also be defined for groups as well. We won't go there in this training. Now, there's a detail group that represents the lowest granularity of data being retrieved by your data set. And it's possible then to add groups that provide summarization at higher levels. All right. Now, the grouping pane also has an advanced mode, and you'll see this shortly in demonstration, and it provides you fine-grained control precisely over how the rendering of the grid will take place. It's something that you might need to do if your table is going to overflow to multiple pages. In fact, our sales order report did this. There might be a need to come in here and configure precisely how, on a new page, that groupings or headers should repeat. Now, when you're going to be working in groupings, then you have to consider how you're going to summarize data at those grouping levels. And Report Builder provides a whole host of aggregation functions, from average to count to first, last, min, max, sum, even running values for the accumulation. Now, if you're going to perform aggregations at higher levels, you can do so in these calculations by providing a scope. So let's look at this example. Using the sum aggregate function, our expression is the value of the sales field. And here we're requesting what the value is at the country level.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so this would be useful, for example, if you've got the salespeople within the country and you want to know what the proportion of that salesperson is over the country itself. The denominator could use this expression to reach to the grouping aggregation. Now, there's one special aggregate function, and it's going to play an important role in the upcoming demonstration, that if you're using the analysis services designer for MDX, we made mention about the fact that server aggregates were supported.
Mm-hmm.
While the report has groupings at higher level, it's not an easy matter of simply summing the detail rows to get the grouping total.
That's right.
A good example of this is if you're requesting the distinct number of customers that purchase from you each month. Now, if you get monthly distinct customers, you can't add them together to produce what the annual distinct customer value is. The only way to do this is that you must either load all of the data, the report must load it and then produce the distinct, or we push it back to the model itself. That's actually the specialization of modeling, is that they perform summarization with measures.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so there's a special capability that when you use the aggregate function in a Tablix, when the data set that the Tablix is using is based on the analysis services designer with MDX,
yes,
it's going to push back and modify that query to retrieve server-level aggregates. To me, this is a remarkable piece of engineering. And it provides you accuracy, and it provides you high performance, and it means you don't need to repeat aggregation logic in the report design itself. All right, let's take a closer look at those variants now. We use a table to present fixed columns with dynamic rows. And essentially what you get is a template. And what's interesting is that template is really just a series of text boxes, but those text boxes behave together in a specialized way.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're formatting your Tablix, they literally are text boxes. They're bound, however, to a single data set, and then we get to control through expressions and groupings about how that grid will be rendered. So, for example, we can see here that there's a table header, we've got a grouping on country, and then the detail rows are the salespeople themselves. Note that the columns are fixed. We would never expect this Tablix to grow any wider than what we know at design time. But vertically, according to the data and the groupings, we don't know. It could be multi-page to render this.
That's true.
The matrix, while its template looks far more simpler, it's actually potentially a very complex configuration. So we've got the ability to add groupings on rows and columns. Therefore, what you're likely to do at the intersection with data is use aggregate functions.
Mm-hmm.
What is a summarization within months, countries, products? All right, remember, we don't know until the report is rendered how wide and how tall this visual will be. So therefore, in fact, I found that rendering, especially large matrices, is best done with Excel.
Yes.
All right, attempting to put it into a print format, sometimes it's just luck that it's not going to span over multiple pages.
Yeah, putting that into a PDF would be quite challenging.
All right, so here's an example of what a matrix would look like. And I've included in this diagram the grouping pane. You can see on the row groups that we've got nested groupings from category to subcategory. And then on the column groupings, we've just got country. And then at the intersection, the values that you see are using the sum function to aggregate the sales values. And lastly, we come to the list, which you've already seen in demonstration. Its template's very simplistic, just a rectangle, but remember, a rectangle is a container. And so therefore, you can cite whatever controls you would like inside. You can even nest other rectangles within the rectangle and achieve grouping. And this is what I think you've already seen, the result of a particular list layout. All right, I think we're ready to see a demonstration of the Tablix flexing its muscles.
This will be great.
Awesome. Stay tuned for the next video and we'll introduce you to the Tablix.